Hello friends, today I am going to discuss about powder crystal method, which is also known as Debye method. So in this method, as its name suggests, powder will be used as a sample. In earlier methods, we have used crystal as a sample. This video is sponsored by GPAD Discussion Center. Visit JDC for GPAD.com for details about GPAD, NIPER, Drugs Inspector and Pharmacist exams. Use Dr. Pushpendra Classes coupon code, that is PK25, and get 25% discount in all online test series of GDC for GPAD.com. Now coming to the radiation source of this method. So just like previous method, which was rotation crystal method, we were using monochromatic beam. So here also we are using monochromatic beam, and this monochromatic beam will be formed by X-ray tube, and finally this X-ray will be converted in the form of monochromatic beam, and it will go further towards the sample which will be present in the axis of the camera. So X-ray is generated by X-ray tube. This complete setup is for X-ray tube, and the X-ray beam is made monochromatic. So here cathode is present, and in cathode tungsten filament will be present, and this tungsten filament will be heated by using high voltage. So it will emit electron, and that electron will hit the anode, and ultimately it will form the X-rays. So this X-ray will go towards the collimator. Then through monochromator, after this processing, we will get the monochromatic beam of X-ray, which is this one. Now coming to the major instrumentation part of this powder crystal or Debye method, which will be like this. So this is the complete instrumental setup of powdered crystal method or Debye method. And as I have already discussed, by using this X-ray tube, we will get the monochromatic radiation, which is this one. So here this monochromatic radiation will enter into the cylindrical camera by using a hole. Then at the axis of this cylindrical camera, powdered sample will be present in any glass tube, or you can say in capillary. Now some of the radiation will be transmitted, and this transmitted radiation will be passed by using a hole. Now this powdered sample will diffract some radiation, and it will reflect some radiation. So it will form different type of cones according to the planes present inside the sample. And this reflected and diffracted beams will form a different pattern in the photographic film. Now coming to the details of this particular method. So as I have told earlier, powdered sample is taken into a glass tube or capillary inside the axis of the camera. So this is the axis of the camera, and this is the capillary. So inside the capillary, we have to take a small amount of powdered sample. Now coming to the second point. So in second point, one hole will be present for entering the monochromatic beam. Then after that, we are having another hole which will help to exit the transmitted beam. Now the transmitted beam will be passed through a hole. So this is the transmitted beam and it is passing through a hole which is present in the cylindrical camera to minimize the fogging due to direct beam. So if this transmitted beam will be present inside, then it may create fogging, means it may create some different patterns in this photographic film. Now coming to the next point. So on the photographic film, diffraction and the reflection pattern will be recorded. So here you can see that we are having powder. So in powder, different type of planes or different orientation of planes will be present, and they will diffract and reflect the radiation which is coming from this hole. Now when it will be diffracted, then it will form a cone like this, depending on the plane. And when it will be reflected, then this cone will be formed backside or left to the sample. So different particles are having different orientation of planes, and they will show different reflection and diffraction pattern. Now coming to this statement, and as per this statement, different particles of the powder is having different orientation of plane, which I have already discussed, and they will show different pattern of cone. So here you can see that it is having different pattern of cone according to diffraction and a reflection pattern. Here one cone is represented by blue color, one is by red color, one is by orange color, one is by black color. So like this, many cones may be present depending on the number of planes, and these cones will interact with photographic film and it will form a specific pattern. Now here I would like to explain this concept by using a model for better representation, and it will be like this. So here you can see that this is our model, and here this is the incident radiation. From this point it is going, incident radiation is going, and from this point transmitted radiation will be out. So when it will be present inside the camera, then this cone will form pattern like this. This is red color, this is for blue color, and similarly in other side also it will be blue color and a red color. And if we are talking about reflected beam, then it will be represented by black color, and in other side also it will be black color, and here it is orange color, and in back side also it will be orange color. So actually position will be like this. Now inside the camera we are getting this photographic film. It will be visible like this in a circular form or in cylindrical form. Now we will open this particular photographic film in the flat form, then it will be like this. So it will form a pattern like this. So ultimately we will get the photographic film having the pattern like this, and if incident angle is theta, theta is equal to incident angle. In that case, reflection or diffraction will be equal to 2 theta. How it will be 2 theta? Let's assume this photographic film is circular. So here this is the incident radiation and it will be reflected. So this particular part or this angle will be theta, and here we are taking complete cone. So this angle will also be theta. So theta plus theta is equal to 2 theta. Now coming to the radius of the photographic film. So let's assume radius of the photographic film is equal to R. And if radius of the photographic film is R, then circumference of that particular circle of photographic film will be equal to 2 pi R. And corresponding to that particular circle, scattering angle will be 360 degree. And by using all these parameters, length of the arc of a circle means this particular length will be like this. And in this case, as per our data, theta is equal to 2 theta. So in the place of theta, we will put 2 theta, and it will be L is equal to 2 pi r into 2 theta by 360. And this equation can be rearranged in the form of theta is equal to 360 into L divided by 4 pi r. So by using this formula, we can calculate the value of theta. And here in this equation, L is equal to length of the arc of a circle. So this is the length of the arc of a circle, which will be length of any two similar pattern. For example, it may be distance from this one to this one for blue color. So from this X-ray pattern, we are getting the value of L, and by using this value and by using this formula, we can calculate the value of theta. Now coming to the Bragg's equation. So as per Bragg's equation, n lambda is equal to 2d sine theta. And when we will get this diffraction or reflection pattern, whenever our crystal or plane of crystal will follow the Bragg's equation, then only we will get diffracted beam or reflected beam like this, which will form the cone. Now let's rearrange this Bragg equation so it will be like this. And as you know, d is equal to a by under root h square plus k square plus L square, which I have already discussed during Miller indices. Link of that video is given here. So d h k L is equal to a by under root h square plus k square plus L square. Now we will put the value of d in this equation, so it will be like this. If we will put the value of d, then it will be a, and rest will be go upside, and it will be converted in the form of under root h square plus k square plus l square. Now let's take the square of this complete equation. So it will be sine square theta is equal to n square lambda square by 2 square is equal to 4 into a square into h square plus k square plus l square. Now, if we will see this particular point, n square may be 1, 2, 3, means it will be order. So n may be 1 or 2 or 3. So n square will be constant. Lambda, if we are taking lambda, so lambda will also be constant because here we are giving a non-monochromatic radiation. So lambda is known to the analyst and it is constant because it is not changing. If we are talking about 4, then also it is constant. And if we are talking about A, so A is also constant. What is A? A is the edge length of the crystal, and the edge length of the crystal will be constant. So this complete factor will be a constant. So if this complete factor will be a constant, so we can say that sine square theta is directly proportional to h square plus k square plus l square. So by using this h square, k square and l square, we can determine the pattern of the plane present inside the crystal. So if we are having the value of h square plus k square plus l square, Then we can predict the pattern of the plane present inside the cubic crystal. For example, if we are having h square plus k square plus l square is equal to 1, it means Miller indices may be 1, 0, 0, or it may be 0, 1, 0, or it may be 0, 0, 1. For better understanding of this concept, you have to watch my previous videos of solid state on Miller indices. Link of those video series is given here. If we are having h square plus k square plus l square is equal to 2, then it may be 110, it may be 101, or it may be 011. So this is the complete details about powder crystal method or Debye method. Thank you.